who all came to the last two lectures? Show of hands, a few of you. Okay, so you gained a little familiarity with the prairie, but and what I'm going to talk about here is a whole other side of it that's not even, you know, the prairie's not that well known, and then fires, you know, a little less known than that even. So, like she said, I'm Logan Blankenship, I'm the assistant superintendent, basically the second in charge of the hotshot crew. The superintendent, Jerry Hoffman, had some prior commitments and couldn't be here tonight, unfortunately, but more than happy to step in. So what I'm going to talk to you about is the crew itself, who we are, what we do. Hey, Vicki, can we turn it down just a little bit? The mic. Who we are, what we do, and why. So that's a big part of it, is the why. Not a lot of people understand that, yeah, there's the fire side of it, but then there's a whole lot of ecological processes behind it too. So,
I'll come to road.
Brief glimpse of what the 2017 fire season was like for us. You can see we traveled all over the U.S., did a lot of different tasks, definitely saw a lot of fire this year. You know, everyone knows we're still hearing it on the news. It's a busy fire year for sure. So we saw much of the same when we were out. So a little bit more, a little background. So what I'm going to talk about, the brief parts here, relate to federal wildland firefighting resources. You know, I'm not an expert in how the state fights fire, how the local, you know, rural fire departments, you know, what I know is my experience, 16 seasons as a federal wildland firefighter. So wildland fire is broken down. It's a three-tier dispatching system. So on your local level, here in Midewin, we're actually dispatched. If there's a fire on the prairie, you know, it's kind of different here because, you know, we pretty much know and we have visual of more or less the entire prairie. If smoke starts flying, smoke comes up in the air, we'll be able to see it. Elwood will report it or Wilmington will report it. But most other places, you know, it's a local unit. There's a fire up in the mountains. Somebody calls it in, whether that's commercial airlines or a lookout that's up at a lookout tower on the top of a mountain. They'll call it in, they'll send it to the local dispatch. They'll dispatch all the local initial attack resources that are responsible for that small area. If the fire gets bigger, it goes up to the next level, which is called the Geographic Area Coordination Center. And from there, they'll basically talk to other local places that are close to that fire and start sending resources from there. When a fire exceeds that capability, then it goes kind of to that next national level. So you can see all the main regions there. Obviously, we're in the eastern region there in Illinois, but 10 major geographic regions for federal wildland firefighting. And the National Interagency Coordination Center, which is that, you know, the national level, it's located in Boise, Idaho, at the National Interagency Fire Center. So wildland firefighting is comprised of four disciplines. There's hand crews, like what I do, smoke jumpers, so we all hear about them all the time. You know, we get it a lot, but I'll hit on it later on about about, you know, are you guys smoke jumpers? I think that's what a lot of people hear on the news and things like that. So kind of the glory position, we joke with them a lot. The, you know, hotshot world and smoke jumping world, there's a little bit of a camaraderie there. You know, a lot of those guys have been hotshots, but when it comes down to it, you know, we all do the same job. It's just mode of transportation of getting there. So, the other two disciplines are engine crews, and those are broken down into different types as well. But then heli-tac crews are the other. So, hand crew typing. So hand crews are generally anything from, you know, 5 or 6 people would be a small local hand crew, something like that. They're responsible for small fires, but then from there it'll go up. There's 10-person wildland fire modules that specialize in backcountry firefighting in places, wilderness areas, national parks, things like that. And then get into the bigger crews like these, type two initial attack, and type one hand crews. So those are all between 18 and 22 people. And then this is kind of hard to read. It's a poor statistic. I apologize for that, but it's just a breakdown. Type two is on the right side. Type two IA, we call it, is in the middle. Type one's on the left. What you would see if I would have chosen a better graphic would be the type two crews. It's kind of your throw together crew, like it used to be, you know, when you're talking the CCC days or back even in the 50s. 1960s is kind of when organized crews came about, but earlier, you know, they'd go and grab 20 guys out of the bar and say, let's go fight a fire. So, you know, and that's, there's plenty of true stories, true accounts out there about that type of firefighting. So, but type two crews nowadays, you know, they're all trained. We all go through basic fire school. You know, it's the most basic thing that you need to get out there and do the job. A few different classes, it's usually a week-long training. You go through, you do a field day along with that, but you learn the basics of fire behavior, a little bit about leadership and the chain of command, how that all works, a little bit about incident command systems, the structure for managing fires, so who's in charge and why, and how does it trickle down from there. Along with those type two crews, they may or may not have Sawyers on them, people that qualified to run chainsaws. So down below, you'd see experience level. Generally, you have a lot of inexperienced people on just a regular type two crew. You know, people that it's their first year or second year. And you'd have one qualified crew boss, a supervisor that's in charge of all those folks. So as you bump over to type two IA, the experience level goes up, the qualifications needed go up, and then you get into a few other things. They do have qualified Sawyers, they do have a minimum number of programmable radios to use in the field. A lot of times the type 2A crews have their own transportation, so they're able to get to where they need to go without having to facilitate renting a bus or doing something like that, which type 2 crews do quite often. So. And then on the left is type 1 crews. Type 1 crews, you know, it's the highest standard when you break it down like this. So much higher experience level, much higher qualification level. You know, we're held to having to have 80% or more of our crew members have to have at least a season or better. So, and then, you know, I think my supervisor's been doing the job, I think, since 1993. So he's been in a long time, and then, like I said, this is my 16th season. You know, the three guys that work directly for me, you know, they're all in about that 10 or 12 year range, so definitely a bigger difference on experience. A few other things, you know, more radios, more capability. You know, we're able to break down into small squads if we need. Really, our big thing as a Type 1 hotshot crew is that we meet the need of the unit, whatever that may be. So if we need to go and say somewhere's having a really bad fire season and we just need to go and help them out and stage for new fires, we can do that. We can break down into, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6 different, you know, smaller modules if we need to go to respond to, you know, new lightning fires or things like that. Or the supervisor or myself, we can break out and go help out in a higher operational capacity. So if we need to go run a division, a certain chunk of ground on a fire, we can do that. So a type one crew versus interagency hotshot crew. Got a few handouts here. Young man, would you mind helping me pass this out? There's a few differences between the type one crew and a hotshot crew. A lot of people throw that term around a little loosely, in my biased opinion. A type one crew can meet all those qualification standards like we showed on the last slide, but take California, for instance. They have a lot of firefighting resources, and you know they have a lot of crews that meet those standards, but they're not an actual hotshot crew. Hotshot crews go through an additional certification process where they're looked at by other hotshot crews, past hotshot superintendents, and they basically have to prove themselves. They have to go through and say, yes, we can operate at this very high level. So then on the handout that you're getting there, you know, there's a few other things that make up why we're a hotshot crew. So federal funding plays into it a lot as well. Hotshot crews are funded on a national level. There's 112 of us nationally. The most recent ones, you know, probably up until, I would say, 10 years ago or so. There was in the 90s, maybe the low 100s. And then, you know, there's always a need for additional firefighting resources. So, you know, funding has been put out there and we've brought a few more crews on board. So, but most of the crews are going to be federal. They're going to be Bureau of Land Management crews, Bureau of Indian Affairs, National Park Service, U.S. Forest Service. There are a few state crews. Alaska has one. Utah has a couple, I think two now. So, and then there are actually, you know, local crews that have met the IHC certification process. So everybody's heard of, you know, the upcoming movie this Friday with Granite Mountain Hotshots. So they were a local municipal crew that met that qualification and certification standard. So, and then there's a few others in California right now. Local fire departments that specialize, they have a wildland division and they've gone through the whole process as well. So like I said, for us, you know, we work for the U.S. Forest Service, part of the Department of Agriculture. We're based there at Midewin. So the crew was established in 2001. The fire season of 2000 was a really, really bad fire season. At that point, you know, they looked at the federal budget. They said, we need more firefighting crews. They brought on 12 new crews that year, 2001. They went through, most of them went through a 2 to 3 year process to gain that certification as a hotshot crew. But my supervisor, Jerry, he was the first person hired on the crew in 2001. He came in as a squad leader, which is the level below me, and then worked his way up through my position, and he's been in his current job since 2012. But it tells you, you know, how much experience he has to be in the position he's in. So our crew is comprised of 22 personnel. We do have a mix of male and female. We started out this season with 3 female crew members. They were all at the crew member, you know, worker level. And then we sent one off to a new permanent job in Michigan, and she gained a higher level. She gained a raise and an appointment as a senior firefighter on an engine there in Michigan. And then the other two, they might be back next year. They're kind of up in the air, but you know, we do recruit. You know, there's a lot of bias, a lot of stigmas for a long time about, you know, only being a male driven job, and it's not the case anymore. You know, we're open to the diversity on the crews. It makes us stronger. You know, everyone brings a different perspective to the crew, and it definitely makes us a better crew to have males, females, you know, diversity all across the board in terms of ethnicity. So the other thing you can see, 7 permanent appointments. So that includes Jerry and myself. three squad leaders below me, and then we have two senior firefighters that are all career employees. So myself and Jerry, we work 12 months out of the year. You know, when it's not fire season for us, you know, we're kind of in our downtime right now. We're working on hiring, we're working on planning for next year, cleaning up the mess that 2017 left. You know, that usually takes 2 months or so. And then, you know, if things really pick up and we're needed again, you know, we are available to go out just single resource by ourselves and go help out where we can. So the other folks, the three squad leaders, they work generally 8 to 10 months a year, and then they get laid off for a period, but they keep their benefits, all that, during that layoff period. And then the two senior firefighters work usually just over 6 months, between 6 and 8 months. So, and then the rest of the crew, the 15 others, are seasonal employees. So they come on, they work for 6 months straight, we work, get as much out of them as we can, and then we lay them off. So that's the majority of the firefighting workforce is seasonal. I would say, I think it's around 30% or something, might have career appointments, but a very large seasonal workforce.
So. Then, what do they do in the meantime?
What's that?
What do they do when they're laid off?
It just depends on what the person wants, you know. They don't get a lot of time to spend that money that they're making in the winter, so a lot of them might go and travel for that 6 months and go sit on a beach somewhere and let their body recover.
They'll make enough money to last a year then.
What's that?
Make enough money in 6 months to last a year.
Yeah, generally. So if they're smart with it, a lot of people just go and roll right into another job. They might go and get a different, you know, this goes into a lot deeper stuff, but if you work in a whole different position on a different unit, you can work another 6 month appointment. So some of them do that. They go work somewhere else. They might go work down in the southeast during their prescribed fire season. And keep working that way, and then just come back to us when we start back up in February. So just depends on what that person's looking for. So you can see, and you saw it a little bit on the video, how much we travel. We have 4 vehicles. But
I just wonder how you happen to get stationed at Midewin.
By choice.
I mean,
you know, I
but the idea that they actually had a hotshot,
that the hotshot crew got stationed
Midewin.
Here. So,
I mean, how many fires do they have in Midewin?
It's not about what's at Midewin, though, for the hotshot crew. So we're a national resource, and I could have explained this a little better, but so we respond to any fire, anytime, anywhere, you know, during our period of availability. So the fact that Chicago is here, you know, you have a major hub here for an airport, it works out really well for us.
Oh, I see.
And then down that bottom bullet there, when they thought of bringing up a crew for the eastern region, you know, they looked at really the most central location. So the eastern region for the Forest Service spans from Minnesota down to Missouri and everything east of there. So really, we're ideally located to go any direction. So that was a big factor in it. So being centrally located and then having the major jet port.
Where's the next closest hot shot for a week? You're not the only one in the whole eastern segment.
We are the only one in the whole eastern region.
You are?
Yep, we're the only hotshot crew. So,
never seen that.
Correct. Yep. Yeah, we do a lot of work in West Virginia. All the time, we're in Minnesota, Michigan. You know, Missouri is kind of our major go-to. But yeah, Pennsylvania, we can pretty much go anywhere.
So it really has nothing to do with the prairie at Midewin?
It doesn't. You know, the prairie is just a bonus on top of it. You know, when you're talking hotshot crews, there's a lot that goes into it about where they want to place them.
You're involved with the, every couple of years, they're burning the prairie. I mean, that's part of your responsibility?
Yep, and we'll get into some of that
okay.
here in a few.
Right.
So,
Kankakee Sands, you go to Kankakee Sands?
Yep. I'll, you know, I'll try and get us out of here before the Cub game, but I do have a little, you know, plenty of time for questions and answers.
Yes.
So,
okay.
So we have 4 crew vehicles and we travel approximately 90,000 miles with those combined per year, you know, between 90 and 100. We're definitely one of the most well traveled hotshot crews in the nation. So, what we do, not this. Kind of what I was talking about. That's the most common thing we get. Oh, you guys are hotshots, so you jump out of airplanes? No. And, you know, I like to puff my chest along and say anywhere that they're jumping out of, an airplane to get to, we're hiking. That's, you know, it's a joke, but it's kind of true.
How heavy is that pack that everybody had on?
I've got one here that I'll show you here in a few, and generally they're 40 to 50 pounds, not usually any less than 40, and you know, for the Sawyers and people that are carrying a little bit more, it's generally 55 or so pounds. So, yeah, it's plenty of weight to make you tired after a full day. So we don't do this, do a lot of this. This is our forte, this is our bread and butter. Putting in hand line, so using tools, scraping in control lines, extinguishing flames that way, building fuel breaks, cutting saw line with the chainsaws. So generally what'll happen is saws will come through, you know, the supervisors will go through, we'll identify where to put the lines, the chainsaws will come through next, they'll cut down any of the hazard trees that are around to make it safe for the crew to get in there, and then, you know, another set of saw teams will come through behind them, you know, make a swath, cut, you know, maybe 6 or 8 feet of brush out, and then the rest of the hand crew comes in behind them and starts putting in the actual hand line, scraping it down to mineral soil, getting all that burnable material out of there.
Is that, I'm going to ask a question because I didn't want to hold up the game, but that's like you're fixing the place that would stop the fire.
Yep, correct.
Fire break.
Yep, fire break. So often this is a picture, and let me go back real quick. This was on the Doghead Fire in New Mexico. That's from 2016. So what that's burning in is mostly a ponderosa pine understory. So fairly open, but a real thick layer of, you know, long pine needles. Burns really hot, especially I think that fire was in June. So June in the Southwest is plenty warm. So often this, a couple times a year, we help out with prescribed fire at Midewin. So the prairie as a whole, you know, it's just a little less than 20,000 acres. And I think roughly 4,000 of that is approved for prescribed fire right now. So they, as more and more of the prairie gets restored, we'll probably revisit that and up that approval to include more of that acreage. But I think this year we did roughly 3,500 acres of prescribed fire, so getting close to meeting that target, which is really good. The fire program, prescribed fire program, the last couple years has almost tripled with what we've been doing from, you know, new management and kind of a different way of doing things to what we did this past season. So generally you go through, the fuel breaks look a little bit different here. You can see where the folks are standing. All it takes there is putting in a mow line through all that tall grass, and then we can come behind with engines or with UTVs and ATVs that have water tanks on them, and you know, we can hold on to it that way, or we use the existing roads. Maybe sometimes we'll tie it into a lake or a creek or whatever and use that for a control feature as well.
What time of the year do you typically burn?
Typically, we do the most burning in early spring, so the first week of April, the last couple of years, has been the best for us. That's when we have a short window, because there's a lot of environmental factors that go into it. Every prescribed fire we do in Midewin has a plan written for it that takes into consideration things that people really care about, like all the species of plants, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Our Midewin botanist is here, so, you know, Shelly would go through, she'd identify what's going to benefit from prescribed fire, you know, if we need to knock back some invasive species that are on the prairie, and, you know, that's kind of how we come up with those areas that we want to burn. So, fall isn't as good, you know, the windows are a little fickle here, you know, it's still real warm, real dry out, so if we tried to burn right now, we might, you know, burn a little too hot and sterilize the soil, or we might just you know, get a little more fire behavior than we want, and then we'd be looking at hurting trees or, you know, burning a little too much brush or whatever the case may be. So, and then all of a sudden we'll get this huge wetting event of rain or snow or whatever the case may be, and the window closes just like that. So it goes from too hot and dry to too cold and wet. So, the spring's just kind of the perfect window most of the time. So, another picture, sometimes we do this, got hazard trees on fires. Right now, I believe we have 5 qualified Sawyers that are the highest qualification level for what we recognize in the wildland firefighting world. So we might go in. This particular tree was it's a picture of me. Get to do that once in a while, but this was on a fire this year, and my supervisor and I, we got to go up to another section of the fire where they didn't have any qualified Sawyers and go help them out and take out some hazard trees so crews could get in there and work.
So a hazard tree is something
that's hazard tree, just something that could cause an issue for the crews, you know, be unsafe for them, something that could either, the whole tree could come down and, you know, if it burned out totally at the base and the whole thing fell and impacted the crews that were in the area, or if it just started burning off limbs and those are dropping down onto the crews. So there's a large number of the fatalities we have, you know, every year caused by hazard trees. So it's a big deal for us. And then, like I said, you know, that's pretty much what we do. Hike into most of the places we're going. You know, that's a fire in Montana this year that there was a dozer that put that line in working downhill, but then had to get out of there through a different way that wasn't as steep. So they can definitely push down the steeper stuff going down, but can't come out of it. So, and that was, you know, what it looked like hiking back up there for us. So, and that was, you know, that's our commute to and from the workplace every day. So, you know, we'll go, we'll drive as far as we can, and then we'll get out and hike into where we need to be. Generally, you know, they throw around the term, that's hotshot country a lot. You know, it's that steeper, rockier, nastier place that, you know they can't put those less experienced folks. And I'll get into a little more, but physical conditioning is a huge part of the job for us, and we take it very serious. So, and that's why, you know, it could be every day, all summer long, that we're in something like that. So the interagency hotshot crew mission statement out of the standards for interagency hotshot crew operations. That's kind of, you know, our Bible. It's what gives us our guidance. All our qualification standards are outlined in that document, but let's read it real quick. The primary mission of the IHCs is to provide a safe, professional, mobile, and highly skilled hand crew for all phases of fire management incident operations. So the priority use of IHCs are for wildland fire incident operations. So in wildland fire, we talk about planned and unplanned ignitions. So planned ignitions are something like prescribed fires in the Midewin that I was talking about. And then unplanned would be either a human start, that somebody's burning their trash pile or their leaf pile or whatever, and it gets away from them, gets out into that wildland, you know, more forested or, you know, grassy area or whatever. Or another unplanned ignition would be, you know, a lightning strike up in the mountains. Initial versus extended attack, I'll get on that real quick. I talked about that, the local dispatch areas, you know, small scale stuff. An initial attack is just right when that fire starts and, you know, the first people to respond to the scene. Generally, it's a kind of a 24-hour rule. We call it the first operational period. It might get extended to 40 hours or something, but you know, they're going to go, they're going to work as hard as they can and try and keep that thing small. You know, everything you see on the news, it's blown up out of proportion, but we're pretty good at our jobs. You know, you look at the number of fires that happen each year, and our success rate is like 97-98% on keeping things in the initial attack phase. And everything you see on the news most of the time is that 2-3% that gets away from us. So the extended attack is when it gets, know, a little bit longer duration. You know, it might only be 2 days, it might be 4 days. It might transition from a small fire to kind of a medium-sized fire. It might be managed with a few more folks and maybe some aviation operations, helicopters, tankers, things like that. and that's kind of an extended attack. And then obviously the long duration fires like what we've got in California right now fit into that extended attack. So. All hazard incident operations, hurricanes, tornadoes, floods. So you heard about all the hurricanes, everything going on with Puerto Rico. We actually have, I think there's 5 or 6 hotshot crews down there right now in Puerto Rico. So they're helping out down there. They, you know, might send saw teams down to, you know, buck leaves, or not leaves, buck trees and debris off of buildings, off of right-of-ways, roads, everything. So, or they might just need, you know, some good hardworking bodies to go and, you know, manage a distribution center. So, Midewin actually responded, the hotshot crew responded to the 9/11 situation. So they went out for 2 weeks and helped out where they could there, worked in a distribution center in New York. So. And then hurricanes, additionally, I think the crew has responded to 2 other hurricanes over the last few years. Tornadoes and floods. This year, the trip down, I guess, second trip down to Missouri that you saw was initially for flooding. We went down, opened up trail systems, really tried to do a lot of hazard tree mitigation at campgrounds and things like that from the devastating flooding they had in Missouri there kind of middle of the summer. And while we were there, there was a couple tornadoes that caused even more havoc. So we went through and helped out there as well. Resource management objectives, you know, we got a good, strong workforce, and when we're not on fires, we're still being paid by the taxpayers, so we want to be productive. So we'll work with the local units, and a lot of chainsaw operations get done. You know, we have, I don't know, 20 chainsaws or something on the crew, and we'll go to a local forest, you know, maybe the Huron Manistee in Michigan, and go, you know, do some thinning projects, trying to thin out the forest and decrease that fire potential for later on. We do a lot of trail construction, fence building, things like that. A lot of stuff that, you know, you need good, hardworking young folks to accomplish. And then training cadres. Like I said, you know, a lot of experience on the crew, and we try to get out and help out with additional training as much as we can. Last year, I flew out to Boise for a week in February and helped out with a class out there that had 25 people from all around that area. And like I said earlier, the big thing is the why. You know, why do we do it? Number one priority on every fire is, you know, for protection of life and property, life being number one. So not just the public, but, you know, ourselves too. Think about it. If we can throw a bunch of resources at a going fire while it's small, it's a lot less exposure for us. When it gets big and it's, you know, romping down the highway or whatever. So, and then the property, you know, comes second, and it's important, but, you know, you look at people's homes and things like that, people's livelihoods, and you look at the devastation in California right now, whatever, the last count was 5,500 homes, I think. So it's really important to us as well. So, and not just that, you know, it might be property, you might be talking bare land, that's used for cattle grazing, you know, and that's how some rancher in Montana makes their money. So they want to get on that fire while it's small and protect as much of that grazing as possible. Additional resources at risk, threatened and endangered species. Who all's heard of the sage grouse? It's been a big topic, you know, the last few years especially. There's a big movement. Obviously, we don't have them out here, but out west, the desert, Nevada, Idaho, Oregon, little bit in Utah, a little bit in Montana, but generally that Great Basin is the greatest concentration. And, you know, fires out there in the sagebrush land, sage and grass, you know, they used to just run, you know, hundreds of thousands of acres, or, you know, burning. The best way to stop it might have been to get out a couple miles ahead of it and start burning off the roads and just slow it down that way, setting a backfire that would move towards that main fire and consume all the fuel in its path and stop the fire that way. But with sage grouse, you know, what we've done is start looking at ways to lessen that burden on the bird itself and lessen the impact of the habitat. And so we've started trying to, you know, bring that in a little closer, stay a little more direct, and then, you know, also employ tactics like maybe some preseason mowing where they would go out and mow in control lines with big tractors and mowers and put in new roads and kind of section those large chunks of land into smaller chunks. You know, if you have to burn a 10,000 acre block so that you can save 100,000 acre, obviously it makes sense. Right? So that's one of the T&E species considerations, and there's a whole list of others. Critical infrastructure, you know, a lot of cell towers, other communication towers located on the tops of mountains. You know, nobody wants a fire to go up and burn that infrastructure and cause havoc that way. So. And then watershed protection is just getting bigger and bigger as well. As people move more into these mountainous areas, and you know, you have to set up well systems, or you have one creek that feeds an entire town, right? You need to go in and try and, you know, do what you can to stop a fire to save that watershed. So. Resource health goes along with, you know, some of those things, T&E species, watershed, but you know, really, we've looked at fire as a bad thing for a long time. And we're coming to realize that, you know, there's a reason it's always been around. It's an ecological process, and not all fire is bad. So, you know, like I was saying with that fire in New Mexico, a ponderosa pine stand, you know, the fire return interval, like how often fire came back through that same area, it might be just 1 to 2 years, you know, in a fuel type like that. The prairie itself, you know, we can go and effectively burn a huge chunk of land there, and everything grows right back and actually does better after that fire. And it'll come right back the next year. I mean, even by midsummer, something we burned in the spring, you know, might be pretty healthy and might have taken out some of those invasive species. And now you have native vegetation growing there, and it might be 4 or 6 feet tall by the middle of the summer. And then recreational opportunities, you know, skiing and mountain biking and trail running and all these things that people like to do in the mountains. You know, imagine going out to the mountains and all you see is black. You know, obviously that's not a good thing. Going camping, everyone likes to get out there and be in the woods. And, you know, if there's nothing left in the woods, then obviously that's not going to be a good camping experience. And then ultimately for us is, you know, we love the job. It's a different type of person that likes to be out there all the time, you know, doing the hard work, being outside. But you know, every day, myself and those around that work on the crew with me, you know, we're out there because we love it. We're not out there because of the money. We're not out there, you know, for the fame and glory and all that. You know, we care about the outdoors. We care about the natural resources. We love the camaraderie that comes with, you know, a hotshot crew, especially being together for 6 months straight. It's a second family. References, but we can get into some more questions now.
What is there a mandatory retirement age for a hotshot?
There is. For federal wildland firefighters, mandatory retirement out of primary positions, which is, you know, on the ground, you're doing the job every day, and then secondary is you've done the job before and now you've moved over and you're in fire management or you're a dispatcher or something like that. Those primary and secondary jobs, retirement age is 57. So, and then there's certain stipulations that go along with it. If you've done a certain amount of years, you might even be able to retire earlier than that. But 57 is kind of that peak. So, and a lot of that's just the physical aspect of it, too.
What's a typical day like for you?
Typical day, I would say the most typical day for the Midewin crew, you know, we've got two seasons. We got our eastern season and our western season. So the eastern season, we go down to the Mark Twain, let's say, and our typical day would be get up, go do our physical training, go meet up with the local resources at the office or whatever, figure out a plan for the day. A lot of times that might be going right out to a prescribed fire, implementing that prescribed fire, hopefully be done by mid-afternoon. And then, you know, down there especially, there's a lot of arson fires. And so once the smoke starts flying from our prescribed fire, the locals will start burning stuff too. And whether they mean to or not, you know, it might just be the locals are burning, you know, their leaf pile or whatever, but there are a lot of intentional starts too. So when they see the smoke flying, they might, you know, start a new fire, and then we leave our prescribed fire, go respond to, you know, the new start, and then work on that as late as we need to, and then shut it down for the day. And it might only be, you know, a lot less daylight that time of year, so it might be a 12 or 13 or 14 hour day. Once we go west, middle of the summer, typical day looks like Jerry and I get up for briefing at 5:15. We go, if we have time, run and grab some food real quick from the caterer. And this would be at a fire camp, so it's, you know, the whole organization is there staying in one place, you know, wherever that may be. But go get some food, go to a 6 o'clock briefing. That usually lasts about a half an hour. We try and be out of camp as quickly as possible. So hopefully we'll be on the road about 6:30 to 7. Drive out to the line, get on the line as quick as possible, and then start implementing whatever the plan is for the day. I usually be out there until, you know, 9 o'clock at night, roughly, you know, on a good long summer day, doing work, and then drive back into camp, hurry and get some food, and hopefully be in bed by 10 to 10:30.
Get up and do it all again.
What's that?
Are there night crews?
Just depends on what the fire needs. You know, if it's in an area that is, it's a high impact, you know, homeowners and, you know, subdivisions, things like that, then yeah, they'll usually run night crews as well that just kind of work an opposite shift than we do. So, but a 16-hour day is the typical thing during peak fire season. So, and then if you're on an initial attack and you're working hard to try and keep it small, you might go up to 36, 40 hours. So, and then if you do that, you know, you do have to take a little bit of extra time off. It might not be 8 hours off the clock. It might be 10 or 12 hours. So.
In a large fire, when there are several groups, do you have a spatial identification from each other? Or how
in terms of how we're talking with each other and working with the other crews?
Well, do you know if this one is from California and this one is from
Oregon? So the federal resources, they're all signed. So like all of our trucks, they have the two-letter state designator and next to a three-letter local unit designator. So ours is IL-MPF, so, and I always laugh about this, but it's Illinois is the state we're from, and then Midewin Prairie Forest is our joke on the crew. You know, that's the designator, the MPF. So if you, you pull up to a fire, you can see that there's an engine crew from Nevada, an engine crew from California, a helicopter crew from Oregon. And then we all have handheld radios and mobile radios in our trucks, and we're able to talk to each other on common frequencies that way, and then talk to the local dispatch area as well.
How about local fire departments? I
mean, local fire departments, we work with a lot. Yep. I mean, so there's a thing we call the wildland urban interface, you know, where the homes meet the wildland, where the homes meet the woods. So generally, if you have a population, you know, you're going to have a rural fire department, a volunteer fire department, maybe a full-time fire department. So if we had something that was really going outside of Kankakee here, or I'll use Wilmington, you know, there's agreements and stuff that go into play with it too. But around Wilmington, since we have agreements with them, we might have a fire that's going down towards Wilmington Piatone Road that's, you know, really getting out of control. They could call us, we could go, we'd tie in with the local fire departments and work right with them as well. So it's called the unified command if it's set up that way. If, you know, if it gets onto Midewin as well, it goes from, you know, private land onto Midewin, then, you know, I would be one incident commander and I'd be right there sitting in the same vehicle with the local fire department fire chief, and we'd be coming out with a plan jointly, so that everyone's getting the same information.
Do you make recommendations as to when people should evacuate?
Yeah, as an incident commander, I would.
Okay. To the local authorities?
Yep, yep. So, you know, if I was in charge of a fire and I really saw the need, then I would urge whoever, you know, I was working with, whether it's local fire department or local police, you know, hey, we need to start these evacuations. And there's a lot of processes that go along with that too, and notifications to different people, but it's more or less how it plays out.
When you do these fire lines,
mm-hmm.
how successful are they?
If you do them right, really successful. I mean, our goal is to not have to do it twice. So,
well,
you know, there's nothing worse than putting in the day's work and then you come back the next day and it's black on both sides. Yeah, I mean, depending on, you know, the fuel type that the fire is burning in, you know, what that available fuel bed is, and then we'll determine tactics and we'll see, okay, we need to put in, you know, a 10-foot wide chainsaw cut and then a 3-foot wide, you know, hand line. Or do we need to just go in and put in a real quick cut with the saws and then come in with pumps and hoses and things, because we have a creek right there that we can set a pump in and not even put in a hand line and just go and start wet the edge down. So, but yeah, I mean, most of the time we come up with a pretty good plan that, you know, we're confident it's going to work, and then Mother Nature will show us something different. So.
Well, the frustration level, you spent all day doing.
Oh, absolutely. That. Yeah. Yeah. One of the worst fires for that I was ever on was, you know, we were working on a fire and it started on this side of a river. The crew worked on it all day long. They put in this huge line going up a mountain and it was mostly a grass fuel type. And the line went straight up and, I mean, it was like 2,000 vertical feet up the hill that it went. And then wind shifted and jumped over to the other side of the river, and then we were on that side for 2 weeks just looking at that line that was in the water. So, pretty frustrating. But
yeah, enjoyed all your explanations. Very good on it. I really like the smoke jumper picture on that. Reason a retired assistant chief, Kankakee City, I flew that airplane.
Nice.
Midway Airlines.
Oh, wow.
The Boneyers that you guys have out there.
Uh-huh.
I flew them.
Wow.
That's
awesome.
Heard from. The explanation is real good on everything. Pretty
cool. Thank you. So,
are you going to show us your equipment?
Yeah, yeah. If we take a pause here on some questions, I'll show you a few things that I've got here. So obviously this isn't everything, but you know, when you think about everything you use every day in your daily life, you know, everything that's at your house and all those nice little luxuries that you have to get by every day. Well, we pretty much live out of a truck for 6 months straight. So my whole life consists of pretty much what I can fit in that black bag right there. So I do have some shelves and stuff in my truck that, you know, I have a few personal items stored there as well, but you know, this is, pull out some stuff here. Like I said, this isn't everything. I have a few things at work still, but a sleeping pad to sleep on, sleeping bag in that pocket, and in here, you know, a few clothes, rain jacket, extra coat. You can see this is my normal day-to-day uniform at work, so Nomex, fire-resistant pants, fire-retardant pants, you know, they do burn. They do get really hot if you're standing too close to fire, but they definitely suppress some of the heat that you would feel. So, this is my regular crew shirt that I wear. This is my Nomex yellow shirt that I wear every day. So, and then a few other little things, another clothes bag. I usually keep two of these, one going dirty clothes, one with clean clothes. So that's pretty much that. This is, somebody asked about our packs. This is a normal pack, and you know, this isn't full weight. I don't know if it totally watered up after my last shift, but gloves, a It's a camelback that's attached to a 3-liter bladder that's inside the pack, a little holster for my radio, another quart and a half of water, another quart and a half of water, the most important thing in my pack, coffee cup. Flagging for signaling water drops from helicopters. So you lay these panels on the ground, they're high visibility for the pilots to see. It's one of the most effective ways to call in a water drop. Warm weather beanie, so my head doesn't get cold. There's less and less hair out there all the time. So.
Oh. Do you ever spend the night in the field or you return into the base?
Most of the time, we try and get back to camp or back to the trucks. There's been a few times, probably less than a half a dozen in my career, that I've slept on the hillside. We used to call it coyoting out. You know, you basically have what's in your pack, and that's a big thing with hotshot crews is, you know, we try and carry enough stuff that there's a fine line between when is the pack too heavy and, you know, do you have enough gear? So, but we try and carry enough that we have supplemental food, we have, you know, 6 quarts of water is what I carry, so 1.5 gallons of water. And on a normal work day, I'll go back to the trucks. If the crew's working hard, I'll go back. I'll hike a 5-gallon cubitainer up to the crew and get them some more water. But, you know, people on a normal work day probably go through, you know, 6 to 8 quarts of water a piece. On a heavy work day, real hot weather, they might go through 10 or 12. You know, 3 gallons of water is what you might be drinking. So headlamp for working at night, extra pair of glasses just for cutting, flagging for marking routes, a few other miscellaneous items. I usually have a GPS in there as well, but it was getting a software update. Gold Bond for when you start getting chafing, it dries the skin back out, it's a savior. So more flagging. Personal first aid kit, fiber tape, binoculars, and then, oh gosh, snack. Like I said, 3-liter bladder in here, additional map case, and then some of the other documents we use. It's called an incident organizer. If I was to respond to a small fire, this would be the information I'd relay to dispatch. Wet wipes for getting cleaned up. Every once in a while, we try and clean our faces, whatever. Supplemental food. We do, you know, a lot of times if we're on a bigger fire, we're gonna get lunches provided by the caterer too, but we always keep, you know, 24 hours worth of food on top of the lunches in our packs, so.
Like dehydrated food?
It's a meal ready to eat, just like the Army eats, so it's not dehydrated, but you know, it is prepackaged, highly processed. Definitely not the best for you health-wise, but it'll get the job done in terms of calories. So, and then an emergency space blanket for those few times that I have had to spend the night on the hill. You know, it came in really handy. So that's pretty much what my pack looks like. And then, like I said, some of our chainsaw operators, they would have additional things like a chainsaw kit that would have an extra chain in it, extra air filters, extra parts. They'd have these right here, they're chaps. So our saw operators wear, we call them snow pants. You know, they're actually chainsaw chaps, just protective wear, but you know, they wear these all day, every day. Even when it's 110 degrees out, yeah. So and they're definitely thick. They're lined with Kevlar weave underneath the orange, and so when a you know something happens, something goes wrong, the chainsaw chain hits the chaps. Basically, it pulls all that weave out and binds it up in the sprocket of the chainsaw, and pretty much immediately stops it. So it's pretty impressive, you know, what the protective gear will do. So, but yeah, wearing the snow pants is not a fun thing. Glad those days are long gone.
What about wildlife when you're in a fire? I mean,
so there's a lot of wildlife, obviously, in the woods, but, you know, they have, you know, that sixth sense. They know when something's not right. A lot of times they're really good about getting out of the areas. The problem we run into most often is that, you know, if we're setting a backfire in front of an oncoming fire, you know, and say we're setting it off a road and then, you know, we loop around both sides to get around the fire that way, and obviously we're cutting off some escape routes for them to get out of there. So, you know, we try and do our best. You know, there's plenty of pictures online of people saving wildlife, baby deer, baby elk. You know, Smokey the Bear himself, you know, was brought up a forest fire. I don't know what the year was, like 43 or something, you know?
Way back, yeah.
Yeah, so a long time ago, fire in New Mexico, you know, a baby bear cub, you know, had his paws all burned, and that's where the Smokey the Bear campaign came from. So it does happen, it's unfortunate, but we do our best to, you know, try and prevent it.
There was a real famous picture a few years ago of this deer standing in the middle of a river or something, and all the flames around.
Yeah, and if you guys saw, you know, I did an article promoting the talk tonight, and it was in the Daily Journal this weekend, and right above my head, we have a picture in our home that's based on that picture that you're talking about from the Clear Creek Fire. Idaho in 2000, you know, that's probably one of the most famous fire pictures that are out there. It's a deep, you know, mountain canyon, river running through it, and there's, I don't know, three elk, I think, that are crossing the river, and all you see is flame behind them. So, but generally, the wildlife's pretty good. You know, they know that something's not right, and they try and clear out the area. So. Another thing that we wear every day, hard hats, just part of our personal protective equipment, so that's on all the time. The thing, I'll hit on tools real quick. So I talked about the saws. You saw in the video, we use leaf blowers when we're in more of the fuel type that we have here in the Midwest and a little bit south of us. If it's, you know, blowing leaves or blowing pine needles, you know, the leaf blowers are very effective in putting in those control lines. For whatever reason, I guess there's a little too much moisture down below that upper leaf layer. If you go through, you blow that whole top layer off, you put in, you know, real easy, you can put in an 8 or 10 foot wide blow line and just stop a fire just like that. You know, it'll get down to that wetter stuff below the layer of leaves. You know, you can usually control it that way. So, but when we're not using those, generally, we have a digging tool. It's the most, famous tool in wildland firefighting. It's called a Pulaski. So it's an axe hoe on this end for actually digging down in the dirt, and then the axe on this side for chopping through roots and such. So, and then intermixed, you know, amongst the crew, it'll be digging tool, scraping tool, digging tool, scraping tool. So this is my personal tool. Looks a little haggard right now. I didn't do a good job of refurbing it last time, but you know, you use the scraping tool to the digging tools, you know, get everything good and chopped up and kind of break that surface tension of the soil, and then the scraping tools will come behind and clear all that away. So, and then kind of the last thing I'll hit on, you can actually see it on my pack. This bottom rectangle is our fire shelter. It can pass this around. I guess I didn't get the other one. It comes in a package. It comes in a plastic package. If stuff was to really go bad, really go wrong, that's kind of our last resort, our last defense, you know, against, you know, ultimately not getting burned over. You know, we pull it out, you know, if we really had to make a run for it, take a quart of water, take our gloves, our radio, and our fire shelter, drop our pack, drop our saws, leave everything else, and try and get to a good spot to deploy that shelter. So I'll pass this around, but this is what it's made of. It's basically an aluminum weed or a layer on each side, and then I don't remember what the inside's made of, but they're glued together, and really just provides a barrier of protection that within those two layers of, you know, aluminum, it's, there's a little air gap in there that, you know, provides a little buffer, but yeah, that's pretty much it. So if we really had to deploy our fire shelters and pull that out of my pack, you know, the newer models have a handle on each side. It's labeled right and left, and then, you know, they're pretty difficult. You can feel how sturdy that foil is, and, you know, you'd have to shake it out, and then you basically step inside of it. It's almost like a little puff tent. You push the outsides out, try and get as much air around you as possible, and then lay down in the dirt face down and, you know, wait for the fire to pass over. So, you know, the deployments that we've had, you know, unfortunately too many have ended the wrong way, but, you know, there have been plenty of successful deployments as well. You know, people have, there's stories of people being in their fire shelter for hours, you know, and the temperatures outside of those can range in thousands of degrees, but you can imagine, you know, what it'd be like inside of that, inside of an oven, and that's your only protection.
Somehow you got to have a lot of air in there to last.
You do. I mean, so that's the important thing about getting down to ground level. You make it as wide as you can, and you give yourself that barrier of air, but ultimately it's not totally sealed airtight, and you know, there's going to be a little bit that sneaks through, and so it's not like you run out of air in there. You know, you could always lift up a little bit of the shelter if you had a good opportunity and get a breath of fresh air.
Well, smoke could be a concern.
Yep. Yep, smoke, superheat gas.
Yeah.
So
the fire consuming oxygen too as it goes.
Correct. Yep. Yep. So the Granite Mountain Hotshots, the 19 folks that perished there in 2013, they all had fire shelters. You know, it's a mandatory requirement. I think some of them were deployed, some of them weren't, some of them didn't even get to that point. That particular fire, yeah, it ran through there way too hot to, you know, even be livable inside that. So.
Yeah, the wind is such a concern in these kind of fires. I would think that trying to keep up to date with in the weather forecast and all.
Yeah,
if you're caught in the wrong side of the fire.
Yep, there's a lot of planning that goes into firefighting, a lot of pre-planning, and then a lot of planning, you know, as it's ongoing. So. A larger fire every day, we're requesting a spot forecast, so calling into the National Weather Service, getting our latitude and longitude of the fire, and saying what are the winds going to be like, you know, for tomorrow, and they'll get us that information. Most of the time, you know, they do their best, they're fairly accurate, they know, you know, what's at stake. So, and then if we're on a larger incident, we actually have on-site meteorologists, so that work with the local management.
This all sounds like a really good movie.
We'll see. I mean, that was my comment with in the paper. You know, I want to see how they tell the story. You know, the question was posed to me: are you going to see the movie? Yeah, I'm definitely going to see the movie. I don't know if Katie will see the movie. She knows how it ends, but I'm definitely going to see it. I want to see how they tell the story. What I've heard is it's a lot more focused on everything that goes into it, you know, before the fact, you know, all the training, all the hard work, everything it takes to get a hotshot crew up and running and certified, and then also the family life, you know, the behind the scenes stuff that you don't hear about. You know, that's a big part of the movie from what I've heard, and then, you know, the fire is kind of the secondary thing. But yeah, I think it should be good. It should be interesting.